There's a few of us here today with all the weather and the snow. I think it's shocked a lot of people. But welcome everybody. Pulpit's a little farther back here today we're doing a little special presentation. But those of us that are here, let's stand together and we're gonna sing as Hiram leads us.
The fire, but I saw you in the flames. Just when I thought it was over, you broke me out of the grave. I'm gonna climb a mountain, I'm gonna shout about it. I am a child of love. I found a world of freedom, I found a friend in Jesus. I am a child of love. Nothing can change the way you love me. Nothing can change the way I belong to you. Yes, I do. Nothing can separate. I'm gonna climb a mountain, I'm gonna shout about it. I am a child of love. I found a world of freedom. I found a friend in Jesus. I am a child of love.
Before you sit down, why don't you greet somebody in the name of the Lord? All right, you can have a seat. I know we have quite a few people away today for lots of different reasons. Now, one person said, I gotta go fix my mom's furnace. It's amazing how many things break down when it's really cold and there's lots of snow. Yeah. I know I was late today just because of shoveling the snow. Got here a little later than I had intended. But it's good to see you. Just a few announcements. We had our men's breakfast and ladies' brunch yesterday. It was good to see a bunch of you out, but I know many of you weren't able to get there. But keep that in mind. Once a month, it's good to get together. Bible study on Wednesday evenings, ESL, English classes on Thursday. So lots of good things happening. So make sure you look on our website and keep up with the things that are happening in our church. Well, it's good to be here today and be in God's house this morning. Did you know that today you have an opportunity to change the world? And I know sometimes we look at our own lives and think, yeah, not going to happen. Not in my life. But it's amazing how one person can change the world. Certainly Jesus did, but then we all write him off like, well, he was God, so of course, right? But what about us? But if you look through history, many people have changed the face of this world just by beginning with one small thing. And Jesus put it this way. He said, "Let your light shine before others that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven." It doesn't say let your doctrine shine or your teeth shine, although it's good. It says let your good deeds shine. In other words, pick something tangible to help somebody with in Jesus' name. Amen? All right. Well, this morning, we're going to start by hearing a little presentation from our Sunday school kids. Let's give them a clap while they come up. Come on up, guys. You guys are awesome.
The parable of the prodigal son. A father and his two sons are at home while Jesus narrates the story.
A man had two sons and a large estate with many servants. The younger son wanted to have his inheritance early while his father was still alive.
Father, give me the share of your property that will belong to me.
As you wish, my son.
Are you serious?
So the father divided the property between them, and the younger son gathered all he had and traveled to a distant country.
In the distant country, a line of salespeople sell their goods.
In the distant country, the younger son squandered his property and spent everything his father had given to him. The younger son hands money to each of the salespeople with excitement until he has no money left. After he had spent everything, he hired himself out to a farmer.
Hello there.
Do you have any work for me?
Yes, I need someone to go out into my fields and tend to my pigs. You must feed them, but you may not eat any of their food.
Yes, sir.
The younger son fed the pigs, but realized how much his life had changed. He would have gladly filled himself with the food that he fed to the pigs.
How many of my father's hired hands have food enough to spare? But here I am dying of hunger. I will go home and say to my father, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worried to call your son. Treat me like one of your hired hands.
So the younger son left the farm to head home to his father. While the younger son was still far off, the father caught sight of him and was filled with compassion. He ran and put his arms around his son.
Son, you are home.
Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.
Servants, quickly, bring out the best robe I have and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Then get a fatted calf and prepare it for us to eat at a dinner celebration. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.
Then they began to celebrate his return. Now the older son was in the field at work. As he approached the house, he heard music and dancing. He called to one of his father's servants.
What is going on?
Your brother has returned and your father has thrown him a celebration because he has come back safe and sound.
The older son became angry and refused to go into the celebration. The father came out to greet him.
My son, your brother has returned. Come join in the feast.
Listen. For all these years, I have been working like a slave for you, and I have never disobeyed you. Yet you have never given me even a young goat so that I might celebrate with my friends. But this son of yours comes back after wasting all your property and you kill a fated calf for him.
Son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours. But we had to celebrate and rejoice, because this brother of yours was dead and has come to life. He was lost and has been found.
This is the story showing God's love and forgiveness. No matter what we do, no matter where we go, no matter how far we stray, our Lord is always there to welcome and forgive us. Thank you.
Yeah, I'll do it. All right. That was great. They'll remember it in a different way for a long time to come. Let's continue to sing. So let's stand as Hiram leads us again in singing.
I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Now, Lord, now indeed I find thy power, and thine alone can change the leper's spots and melt the heart of stone. Jesus paid it all to Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. And when before the throne I stand in him complete, Jesus died my soul to save, my soul shall still repeat. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. If faith can move the mountains, let the mountains move. We come with expectation, waiting here for you. Waiting here for you. You're the Lord of all. You are everything you promised. Your faithfulness is true. And we're desperate for your presence. And all we need is you.
Have a seat. We're going to pray together. I just want to start by saying thank you to everybody who has been praying for my wife, Diana. We have felt your prayers. The last couple of days, she's been off her heavy painkillers after her brain surgery, and the surgeries went well. We can praise the Lord for that. It's always a little scary when you're doing something with the brain, right? So we are very thankful for that. However, you don't just go into the brain and just heal right away, even though the hospital kicked her out the next day. But the first week has been tough with headaches and so on and pain. Last night she was a little bit dizzy, but at least the headaches are subsiding and the pain is getting a little less. So she's getting up a little bit more each day. So thank you for your prayers. Just keep praying for her. And it's always good to be part of a church that does pray. So thank you. For those of you who know Mavis, if you don't, she's the lady in our church that has a couple of twins out to here. Anyways, Shirley Ann has just taken her to the hospital to do some infusions. She's due very soon. So keep her in your prayers. It's tough husband and her kids still need visas to get over here, so she's all by herself here, so it's been tough. And it's good to have Sam back. It's good to see Sam after being away for a little bit. So welcome back, Sam. And it's good to have everybody else here. Thank you for joining us this morning. And we continue to pray for you. And please, if there are things you need prayer for, by all means, please talk to us. Everyone in this room has something that they need help with. And we live in a very needy, difficult world. And so we come to this amazing God and bring our requests. And God cares. Let's pray. Lord, we are so grateful that you do answer prayers. Thank you for keeping my wife safe through surgery. Thank you for Diana and all she means to me. Pray for Mavis. Continue to keep those twins safe and bring her husband here soon. Look after the visas. For our Nigerian team, God, continue to work your wisdom in helping our immigration people to get the visas so that we can keep them here. God, we pray for the partnership with other churches through them, and I pray you continue to guide in that as we seek to reach out to the city. God, I pray you continue to guide us through your Spirit to give us wisdom to who we speak to and who we touch. Lord, sometimes we can feel overwhelmed by the need, and yet you are here to help us. Give us the courage to just do one thing to care for somebody each day. Give us the courage to go beyond our own comfort, to deny ourselves daily and follow you. God, I thank you for Gabriel and all he does with the young adults and with the youth, and continue to bless him and strengthen him. God, we thank you for our Secretary Mabel. I pray that you would continue to heal her back and give her strength each day. Pray for Curtis and Elaine. You'd watch over them in their homes. For Millie and Ralph, for Laura Taylor, for Bernie Bowden, and many others who are not able to be here this morning. Pray for Brian this morning, that you would strengthen him. God, I just thank you for putting us in this family, to know that you are here with us this morning, that you care about each one of our needs. God, we come to you not only for your blessing, but we come to you to learn from you today. I pray that you would open our hearts to your Spirit. Fill us with your Spirit, Lord. Touch us. We need your grace this morning. I pray all of this in your precious name. Amen. Yeah, if the kids want to come up again just for a minute, let's just pray before you go downstairs. Come on, you don't have far to go, so come on up. Did you like doing that little play? Do you like doing that stuff, or do you get scared up here? Who of you were scared being on the platform? Anybody? You were, yeah. A little bit scary. Yeah, when I did it first time, boy, that was scary. But you know what? You keep doing it, you'll get better. And one day, one of you is going to be a pastor. Maybe a few of you. See? Let's pray before we go downstairs, shall we? God, I just thank you so much for each person up here. Thank you for the gifts you've given them. Thank you for making them uniquely themselves. God, you created them just to be them. They don't need to be anybody else, just them. Just bless them as they go down to learn from your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks for coming, guys. Go on downstairs. Walk in. Thanks, guys. Our scripture reading is from Luke chapter 8, verse 16 to 18. No one lights a lamp and hides it in a clay jar or puts it under a bed. Instead, they put it on a stand so that those who come in can see the light. For it is nothing hidden that will not be disclosed, and nothing concealed that will not be known or brought out into the open. Therefore, consider carefully how you listen. Whoever has will be given more. Whoever does not have, even what they think they have, will be taken from them. And may God help us to understand His word. If the ushers want to come forward with the offering this morning, just a reminder, you can give online if you're at home, or if you're here, you can give in person.
Can't explain peace that stills my soul. Light in the darkest place, life, even in the pain, it feels like coming home. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. I am free, amen. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. I am free, amen. Here I'm alive again, gone is the weight of sin, oh sweet liberty. Praise God who saved my life. I'm bought with the blood of Christ. The Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. I am free, amen. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. I am free, amen. Free at last. Thank God.
Thank you, Hiram. Feeling free this morning? Amen. We have a great God who sets us free. I want to talk today about something that you have all seen and experienced, the ripple effect. Anybody know what I'm talking about when I say the ripple effect? Few of you. Okay, well, we're going to play a little video and you'll see very quickly. But ripples happen all the time with water. You've seen it on water. One little drop and this ripple. I've always been amazed by ripples. You know, just one little drop, and that ripple just keeps going, doesn't it? Even if it's just a little thing. It can be a little bug on the water, right? A little pebble, a little something, a little raindrop, and it just spreads, and it just keeps going. In fact, it's amazing how in the ocean, you can have a movement under the sea that can start the waves moving for miles and miles and miles. You know, tsunamis or, you know, an earthquake or even a ship going by, and those waves can spread for miles. And so today we talk about the ripple effect, which really is talking about how one small thing can have many, many ripples that move out from that event. And there's a classic poem that's written about this. It says this: for want of a nail, the shoe was lost. For want of a shoe, the horse was lost. For want of a horse, the rider was lost. For want of a rider, the message was lost. For want of the message, the battle was lost. For want of a battle, the kingdom was lost. All for the want of a horseshoe nail. It's amazing the effect of one little thing of how it goes. I'm just going to play a little video here, and I'll explain it as it's playing. But you're going to see a time-lapse video, and I may have shown this a number of years ago. Every dot, red dot on that screen represents 17 refugees. And this is a time lapse as you see different events in the world. So, for example, what's happened in Afghanistan, what happened in Syria. As soon as that event happened, you see this movement of refugees and this people going to all different countries around the world, millions of people. What is amazing to me is this ripple effect happens often because of one decision. Saddam Hussein, Bashar al-Assad in Syria made a decision, and Syrian war happened, and people went all over the world. And people are in Canada today because of that. Biden made a decision to pull the troops out of Afghanistan, and Afghans spread all over the world because of that. And so you see this ripple effect can happen just because of one person or one event, one little thing. You know, a little lab, we don't know exactly, but let's say there's a lab in Wuhan in China. We all know about that, don't we? Changed the world with COVID, right? One terrorist, and all of a sudden, all over the world, we have security at the airports and so on. Did you know there's a ripple effect that connects Roman chariots to NASA and the space shuttle? I was just reading about this. See, the Romans built roads all over Europe. And roads were built for chariots, which were pulled by two horses side by side that would create ruts. And so, with all these roads all over and these ruts, eventually when carriages and horse carts were built, they built them the width of those ruts. And so eventually trains were invented, and some of the places they went were where some of these roads were, and so they built train tracks to fit the ruts. And eventually trains in the States and North America happened in the same way. When cars were invented, the width was similar to take advantage, the width of our cars, to take advantage of those roads. When the space shuttle came along, they had to go through a tunnel that was made for, designed with that same width. So the shuttle actually had to be designed to fit those roads. So it's amazing that the space shuttle actually had some effect from those Roman roads. Incredible. In the last number of years, we've had this discussion. I don't know if you've heard this term, 6 degrees of separation. And basically what it says is there's this theory, this social theory, that every one of us can be connected within 6 relationships to anybody else in the world. And it's amazing to think that we are all connected and that we can have an impact on people on the other side of the world. Which means that what you do and one thing you do has an effect, has an impact beyond yourself, kind of a ripple effect. And on it goes. Here's the bigger question for you and me. What it comes down to is this. Does what you and I do matter? Does anything I do affect you? See, we get this deception, particularly in Canada, that if I just mind my own business and I go to work or go to school or whatever I'm doing, visit with my friends, I live behind closed doors, do my job, care for my family, does any of that affect anybody else? I mean, even if we're in some obscure way connected with 6 degrees of separation to everybody else in the world, does it really matter? Well, when I look in the scriptures, the Bible would say, yes, it does. It does matter. I want us to go back to the Old Testament, to the book of Joshua. We've been walking through the scriptures. We've looked at some of the themes in the first 5 books. And today we want to come to the book of Joshua. And if you've been following along, remember, Israel has escaped from slavery in Egypt. They crossed the Red Sea, wandered in the wilderness for 40 years, and now, with leaving Moses behind, Joshua is leading the people into this promised land, this land anticipated that God was going to give them, this new land that God had promised. Now, here's the problem. Just because God is telling you to go to a new land, and some of you feel maybe that God has called you to this new land, but just because God calls us to a new land doesn't mean it's going to be easy. I mean, when the spies from Israel went into Canaan, they came back saying, there's giants in there. And I'm sure the people living in Canaan weren't saying, oh, did God tell you that he was going to give you this land? Oh, well, by all means, come, please take everything that we have. It's all yours. Come on in. No, that's not what happened, is it? They had to fight for this land. In order to inhabit and conquer this new land meant that there was going to be battles. There was going to be hardship. It was going to be very difficult. And remember, these are not battle-hardened soldiers. These are not people trained for battle. These are people who used to be slaves, men, women, and children, older people, who used to be slaves in Egypt. And then they've just been wandering around the desert for 40 years. They're not trained for battle. And then they come into this promised land. Remember, God has given them everything they've needed, food and water, everything they needed. It says that their sandals didn't even wear out in the desert. And now they come to their first battle, to Jericho, in Joshua chapter 6. First battle in Canaan. This is not an easy battle. And in fact, remember, like God bringing them to the edge of the Red Sea, God bringing them to a place where there's no water, God will often bring you to places where you hit the wall, where you can't go forward without God helping you. And here in Canaan, once again, they come to Jericho. This was not an easy, there were plenty of other smaller little villages they could have fought. God takes them to Jericho. Jericho has walls that are 6 feet thick. Can you imagine trying to get through that? They don't have dynamite back then. They don't have big tanks and everything else. They got to somehow figure out how to conquer this city. And the people inside are sitting tight because they think they'll never get in here. They felt safe. And if you read the story, we're not going to read that story today, But God orchestrates an incredible victory where they march around and they blow their trumpets and they pray to God and the walls crumble. In fact, history has even shown, archaeology has shown, these walls of Jericho that crumbled. Except on one side, where there are houses built into the wall, and where Rahab lived. And if you remember the story of Rahab, Rahab is the one who sheltered the spies and said, "Please protect me," and God spared her life. And on the seventh day, as they walked around, these walls fall, and Rahab, the prostitute who saved the spies, is spared. Now, coming out of that fight, Israelites are feeling pretty good, right? Man, we can beat Jericho. We can do anything, right? God's fighting for us. This is good. And so they move on with they're confident. They're excited. They think, we can take on anybody. And they go to the next town, and something happens bad. Joshua chapter 7, we're going to read from there. Now Joshua sent men from Jericho to Ai, which is near Beth-Aven, to the east of Bethel, and told them. So the men went up and spied out Ai. When they returned to Joshua, they said, "Not all the army will have to go up against Ai. Send 2,000 or 3,000 men to take it, and don't weary the whole army, for only a few people live there." So about 3,000 men went up. They were routed by the men of Ai. In other words, they were just totally defeated, who killed about 36 of them. They chased the Israelites from the city gate as far as the stone quarries and struck them down on the slopes. At this, the hearts of the people melted in fear and became like water. Can you imagine? They've just had this amazing victory in Jericho, and they go up to Ai, this is just a little village, no problem. And they go up, and they just totally get destroyed. It's like, what is going on? What happened? And so Joshua's thinking, yeah, what's going on? And so they go up, and Joshua says, "I have no idea what's going on. We got to pray." And so the Lord said to Joshua, verse 10, the Lord said to Joshua, of Joshua chapter 7, verse 10, "Stand up, what are you doing on your face? Israel has sinned. They have violated my covenant, which I commanded them to keep. They have taken some of the good things. They have stolen, they have lied, they have put them with their own possessions. That is why the Israelites cannot stand against their enemies. They turn their backs and run because they have been made liable to destruction. I will not be with you anymore unless you destroy whatever among you is devoted to destruction." See, when they went into Jericho, God had said, "You need to destroy everything. Do not take anything for yourself." In fact, archaeology has shown that in the rubble of Jericho, they found remnants of something being burnt. They were told to burn it to the ground. But notice that God says in verse 11, Israel has sinned. My guess is that not, we're going to read this later, but not everybody had done wrong, and yet God says, Israel has sinned. They have violated my covenant, which I asked them to keep. They have taken some of the dough, they have stolen, they have lied, they have taken possessions. And God kept them all accountable for the sin of something that a few had done. What's interesting about this accusation, when they began to weed out who has done this thing, it comes down to one man. One man, Achan. And God says, Israel has sinned. They have sinned. After they had been praying and kind of figured out and had finally found out who it is, then Joshua said to Achan, "My son, give glory to God. Lord, tell me what you've done. Don't hide it from me." Achan replied, verse 20, "It is true. I have sinned against the Lord, the God of Israel. This is what I have done. When I saw plunder, a beautiful robe from Babylon, 200 shekels of silver, and a bar of gold weighing 50 shekels, I coveted them and took them. They are hidden in the ground inside my tent with the silver underneath. Interesting contrast, isn't it? God says, they have sinned, Israel has sinned, and Achan says, I have sinned. Why? The ripple effect. The ripple effect. See, don't ever think that just because you do one thing and you don't think anybody else has seen what you have done, that it doesn't affect others around us. What you do in private affects our whole body of Christ. It affects the church. It affects this city. It affects this world. What you do in private is not done in a vacuum. Your sin always affects those around you. I've seen this in my own life, regrettably. I make mistakes and I see it affecting my family. I've seen it in every church I've pastored. So here's another question. Why was Achan's sin of stealing so bad that if you read on, you find that God gathered his entire extended family and had them destroyed because of his sin? Why? Why was he so harsh? Well, first of all, it was at the very beginning, and God had, remember, we've talked about this, God setting a foundation for this new nation that needed to be different from the surrounding nations. It needed to be different to even stand out, that there was a different God among them. And God knew that if he didn't deal with this sin, it would continue as they spread throughout Canaan. What's more, remember, Achan, he's a good guy. You know, he's helping. He's a father. He's helping in battle. But he affects those around him. I'm sure there were others that saw him take that stuff from battle, but didn't say anything. His family probably saw him hide it under his tent and didn't say anything. And what happens is people start to think, hey, Achan can get away with it. Maybe in the next battle, maybe there's some stuff there that I can take. And it spreads. And God says, uh-uh. We got to deal with this seriously. See, there's several things we need to learn from this negative ripple effect. First of all, Achan knew better. He had been under the instructions for the Battle of Jericho, where they had been told, do not take anything. This whole city must be destroyed. He knew a better way to live, but he still wanted to hang on. See, we all know what the right way to live is often, but we choose to hang on to something because we think, well, I know it's a good thing, but nobody will really know about what I'm doing. Especially in this country where we live behind our closed walls. We live in our own worlds often. And we deceive ourselves into thinking that what I do doesn't matter. Secondly, Achan's sin affects those around him. His family knew. Other soldiers probably knew. And they're probably hoping that they could get away with it in the future. We have a lot of privacy in Canada, don't we? We value privacy. You come to somebody's house, they might not even let you in this country. But that privacy can be very deceptive. Just because you don't have grandmas and grandpas and family and others around you watching what you're doing doesn't mean that no one's watching you. God knows what you're doing. It's so easy to start taking things that are supposed to be devoted to God. Nobody can tell what you're giving to the church. We don't check up on you. And it's so easy. It's like, man, I'd really like a new TV, so I'm just going to keep this money. I know I should be given to God. And so often we take the things that are devoted to God for ourselves because we think nobody's looking. But your sin affects us all. When we steal God's money or His time, His gifts, we're stealing from all of us. When we sin in private, it affects all of us. When we withhold love from people who desperately need it, we are withholding love from all of us. Just this week, I've had a couple of people in our church say, you know, it's really nice to come to church on Sundays. People say, I love you, and they smile. But I need help. And I don't see people helping me, and I need help. And we withhold our love times. Some of us have said, you know, I just long for community. I wish we had better community in this country. We want more. And I'm here to tell you that community starts with you. If we want to build a strong community, it means coming together when we offer different things. It means starting something yourself. It means building this community so that it's something that people want to come to. Community starts with you. See, in Achan's case, there was no accomplices. He did it by himself. Nobody even saw him do it. Maybe they did. We don't know. But because of what he did, the whole army became paralyzed by fear. They knew something was wrong, and it affected them going into battle. 36 men died. 36 women became widows because of that one man's sin. How many children no longer had a father because of that sin? People, don't ever let Satan deceive you into thinking that sin has no effect. What I do doesn't matter to somebody else. This is why Paul talks about the body of Christ. The thumb can't say to the rest of the hand, I don't need you. You chop that thumb off, it's dead. It's not going to work well. Sin has a natural leavening effect. It grows and moves. It increases. It doesn't just lie there and die. And so we need to do things to keep it from spreading. We need to pursue holiness. And because we're interconnected, we need to pursue our relationships with each other. The ripple effect. Now, here's the good news. See, one man's sin can affect the whole nation. But one man's love and goodness can also change a whole nation for good. Amen? See, while Israel was languishing under the burden of Rome and the legalistic Pharisees and scribes, Jesus says, I will do what's right. I will go to the cross and die for the whole world. I will make a difference. The ripple effect. And as people began to follow Jesus, they spread out and began to change the whole world. It's because of the disciples of Jesus that churches began to grow up. They began to write letters. Those letters were consolidated into what we have now as the Bible. That has changed the world forever. People have tried to destroy the Bible, get rid of it. It just keeps going. More copies of it are made than any other book in the world. It's because of the church that we have hospitals and schools and many other things were begun because of Christians. I have a friend that I went to school with. He went back to India and he found this village of bond slaves. That's another story I can talk to you about. But there are people in India who have a price on their head that they can only find freedom if you pay to release them from the work that they do. And he went into this village and he asked the boss who worked all these people, these bond slaves, says, how much does it cost to free them? And the boss said, $32,000. He raised that money and saved that whole village. And today they have a church and schools and so on. One man who chose to make a difference. I met another man when I was a student over in Irian Jaya, a place in eastern Indonesia. He went over there to translate the Bible. And he translated the Bible so a whole nation could learn about Jesus. One man. Mother Teresa said this, I alone cannot change the world, but I can cast a stone across the waters to create many ripples. Malala Yousafzai said, one child, one teacher, one book, and one pen can change the world. Another lady said, never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it's the only way it ever has. You put Jesus into that mix. The power of the Holy Spirit into that mix. And imagine what this church can do. It just takes one of us to say, I will live differently. I will choose to help my neighbors. I will choose to love even if they don't respond. I will choose to give even if nobody else does. And watch what happens in this city. When Achan took a step in the wrong direction that crippled his nation, there was a lady, a prostitute, that said, I'm going to stand with this people of God. I want to stand with their God. I have seen this God of my city, in spite of my people. I'm going to stand with them. And because she did, her life was spared. And Matthew chapter 1, verse 5 tells us that Rahab, that prostitute in that destroyed town, was part of Jesus' lineage. She was brought into the lineage of the Son of God just by a choice she made. You want to be part of that? Let's make some ripples in this city. Amen? We're not going to do much good ripples unless we have Jesus. We need Jesus. Every day, begin your day saying, God, I am nothing unless you put strength into my day. Unless you fill me with your Spirit. But if Jesus fills you with his Spirit, nothing can stop this church. Amen? Here's just a few simple things you can do. And then we're going to go into our time of communion. Just plan some time in your day to listen to somebody. In our closed doors, there are so many people, many of them that are not here today, who just need somebody to listen to them. Take to build relationships. Like Jesus. He didn't just say to Zacchaeus, hey, love you, brother. What did he do? He says, I'm coming to your house. When he got to the house, that's where the change happened. Get into people's houses. Build relationships. Secondly, start by just doing one small kind act of kindness today. Even if nobody knows about it, doesn't matter. The ripple effect. The Bible says, true religion is this, caring for widows and orphans. Simple. Third, choose what to do what's right regardless of the circumstances. You can come and tell afterwards all the things that are going wrong in your life, but choose to do the right thing in spite of it. And then last, choose to put God first with your eyes, with your thoughts, with your actions, with your words, put God first in your money, especially when no one is looking, and watch God change. As we come, prepare for communion, and then Haram is going to lead us in a singing. God, I pray this morning that you would show us how my life can better reflect you and your word. God, help me not to be complacent and live for comfort, to seek to glorify you. God, give me eyes to see the lives around me who need to hear your word, those who need to experience your love and your grace. And may you use me to do good works and share with these people. All I have is from you, and may you use it to bring you glory. In the name of Jesus, amen. Just stay seated and let's sing In Christ Alone as our leaders come to help us with communion. And let's prepare our hearts for communion.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving
Jesus could have found 1,000 reasons not to go to the cross. His disciples doubted him, didn't listen to him half the time, were always fighting. He knew the Romans and the Jews wanted to kill him. He could have just said, "That's it, I'm done." But Jesus said, "I don't care what anybody else says, I'm going to follow my Father. I am here to serve my Father. And I will die for my Father if it means saving someone." The ripple effect of one godly man, the Son of God, Jesus Christ. I thank God that he died for me. Amen. Let's pray. God, thank you so much that you were willing to die for us on that cross. At any point you could get given up. And yet Paul in Philippians says that you became obedient even to death. Every last breath of yours was given in serving. Even from the cross, you didn't quit serving. You even cared for the thief said, "Today you'll be with me in paradise." God, thank you for your broken body for us. In Jesus' name, amen. After the meal, Jesus took the bread and he said, "This is my body broken for you. Let's eat it together in remembrance of him." After the meal, Jesus took the cup. He says, "This cup, this wine, is a new covenant in my blood." Even before Jesus was on the cross, he was committed to it. He said, "My blood will be spilt for you." He didn't wait around to see whether his disciples were going to sign a contract, do the right thing. He says, "I'm dying for you. This is a covenant regardless of your choice," which means even this morning, some of us feel like we haven't done well. We've messed up. Jesus says, "Okay, my covenant is with you forever anyways." Aren't you glad that Jesus' covenant goes on forever, regardless of how well we keep it? If it was up to us to keep that covenant with him, it'd be over. But while we were still sinning, Jesus dies for us. While we're still sinning, Jesus says, "I will stand by my Father and intercede for you." So this morning, if you don't know a close relationship with Jesus, come to him today as we celebrate this communion. Chunku, would you like to pray and thank God for his shed blood?
Let's pray.
Sure. I'll just stand near you.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for your shed blood. We are praying that everyone who partake of this, not just be a symbol of belonging in you. It should be following your footsteps and doing the right thing. Heavenly Father, we pray that everyone partaking in your meal, in your shed blood, should be blessed and sanctified. Pray all this through Jesus Christ, your Son of our Lord. Amen.
Jesus said, "This is my blood shed for you. Let's drink it together." God's been here this morning, and let's stand together and let's celebrate this amazing God as we sing together in closing.
There is nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare your your presence.